فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. Inshallah ta'ala, we're in the explanation of the Kitab al-Waraqat لِلْإِمَامِ أَبِي مَعَالِي الْجُوَيْنِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. We spoke previously about the أحكام الأحكام التكليفي and الأحكام الوضعي. So inshallah ta'ala, today we're going to go into another istidrad that the author does, another point in which he goes into. نعم. سم.
Fiqh has a narrower meaning than knowledge, al-ilm. Knowledge, ilm, is to know the thing known as it actually is. Ignorance, jahl, is to imagine something as other than what it actually is. Immediate knowledge, ilm dururi, is that which does not result from rational or evidentiary inquiry, like knowledge that is known by one of the five senses. Whereas acquired knowledge, ilm muqtasib, rests on rational and evidentiary inquiry. Rational inquiry, nadhr, is reflection on the object of inquiry. Evidentiary inquiry, istidlal, is the search for evidence. Evidence, dalil, leads to what is sought, the hukum. Opinion, dhan, is acknowledging two possibilities, one of which is more probable than the other. Doubt, shak, is acknowledging two possibilities, neither of which is superior to the other.
والفقه أخص من العلم، والعلم معرفة المعلوم على ما هو به، والجهل تصور الشيء على خلاف ما هو به، والعلم الضروري ما لم يقع عن نظر واستدلال، كالعلم الواقع بإحدى الحواس الخمس التي هي السمع والبصر والشم والذوق واللمس، وبالتواتر والعلم المكتسب ما يقع عن نظر واستدلال، والنظر هو الفكر في حال المنظور فيه، والاستدلال طلب الدليل، والدليل هو المرشد إلى المطلوب، والظن تجويز أمرين أحدهما أظهر من الآخر، والشك تجويز أمرين لا مزية لأحدهما على الآخر.
The author رحمه الله لما ذكر المصنف، when the author mentions الفقه استدرد، he just went off again in mentioning the issue pertaining to knowledge. And then when he mentioned the issue pertaining to knowledge, he then started to speak about the types of knowledge there are, and then the opposites of knowledge. And then he started to speak about that which is known as al-idrakat, the perceptions and ways to perceive matters. So all of this topic right now is known min al-istidrad. The author has slightly gone off topic, but we'll show you how he has and where he went. Before we were talking about al-fiqh, right? We were talking about al-fiqh, right? And we defined what al-fiqh meant. The Sheikh already, rahimahullah, he defined for you what al-fiqh meant, right? And he gave you an understanding, which is ma'rifatu al-ahkam al-shar'iyya. It is to know the ahkam al-shari'a ala sabil al-ijmal, right? So we already took that, an explanation of it. Here he tells you that fiqh is more specific and is more narrowed down than knowledge. Okay, it's more. Because not every knowledge is a fiqh, but every fiqh is knowledge. So knowledge is more broad. Are you with me? For example, you can say ilmu tafsir. You can say ilmul hadith, ilmul nahw, ilmul balagha, and other than that. Whereas fiqh is not tafsir, it's not hadith, it's not nahw, it's not balagha. Fiqh is actually more narrowed down. It's actually a, whereas knowledge encompasses all of that. So we will say is, فَكُلُّ فِقْهٍ عِلْمٍ. Every fiqh is knowledge, but not every knowledge is what? Fiqh. So that's why he said, وَالْفِقْهُ أَخَصُّ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ. It's more specific. Because الْفِقْهُ, according to the أُصُولِيِّينَ and the fuqaha, it refers to which one? Which ahkam? Al-ahkam? Al-shar'iyya? Al-talabiyya? Remember we spoke about it. Al-fiqh, according to the usuliyin and the fuqaha, it refers to what? Al-ahkam, al-shar'iyya, al-talabiyya. And it doesn't refer to any other ma'lumat, any other knowledges that are out there. The difference between the usuliyin and the fuqaha, even though they all agree that it is al-ahkam, al-shar'iyya, al-talabiyya, there is a difference within themselves as well. Because the usuliyun are the ones who believe is يختص بالاجتهاد, specific to اجتهاد. We mentioned that yesterday. They believe is الأحكام الشرعية الطلبية الاجتهادية. That's the أصوليين. The فقهاء believe is جميع الأحكام الشرعية الطلبية. Does that make sense? And we spoke about that yesterday. This extra قيد that the أصوليين add to the definition. But they both agree and they both accept that fiqh is specific to al-ahkam al-shar'iyya al-talabiyya. So from this angle, if fiqh is specific to al-ahkam al-shar'iyya al-talabiyya, then that means al-tafsir doesn't enter there, al-hadith doesn't enter there, al-nahu doesn't enter there, al-balagha doesn't enter there. But then within themselves, the usuliyin and the fuqaha, even though they agree that it's al-ahkam al-shar'iyya al-talabiyya, within themselves they differ. Because the fuqaha, they say, it is all of al-ahkam al-shar'iyyat al-talabiyya. And the usuliyin, they say, no, it is al-ahkam al-shar'iyyat al-talabiyya, which is what? Mukhtasun bil-ijtihad, specific to ijtihad. Then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, so now we understood what he means, wal-fiqhu akhassu min al-ilmi. Then the author, rahimahullah, goes into, and he says, wal-ilmu ma'rifatul ma'lumi ala ma huwa bihi fil waqi'i. He says, wal-ilmu. So now why is he going into the issue of knowledge? Because he just now told you that al-fiqh akhassu min al-ilmi. So you might ask yourself, what is knowledge? So then again, he defines knowledge for you. Are you with me, brothers? So that's where the istidraj is coming from all the time for the author. So he speaks about al-ilmun again. Ilm means ma'rifatul ma'lumi ala ma huwa bihi fil waqi'i. So ilm is murakkab min amrayni. For Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni, two things he mentioned in the definition when he defined knowledge. Two things. His definition of knowledge, it composes of what? Two points. It's a compounded of two things. The first one is ma'rifatul ma'lum. It's knowing the thing. وَهُوَ الْمُدْرَكُ الَّذِي تَعَلَّقَ بِهِ الْعِلْمِ. It's the thing that the knowledge is connected to. So you know this thing. Okay? Now, just because I know it, the second part is missing. Which is what? As he says, ma'rifatuhu ala ma huwa bihi fil waqi'. That what you know of it is exactly what the reality of it is, which is a second. Are you with me? And that, inshallah ta'ala, we'll understand that more when we come to the chapter of al-kalam, speech. When we speak about al-haqiqa and majaz. When we speak about haqiqa and majaz, we're going to understand the haqa'iq and the reality of things. The author is going to speak about it there. Then the author now, pay attention to this. He spoke about knowledge, right? Why did he speak about knowledge? Because he said, وَالْفِقْهُ أَخَصُّ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ. And then he told you what knowledge is. Then the author had to force him, then he was forced to give us the opposite of knowledge. Because the qa'ida is الضِّضُّ بِالضِّضُّ. The opposite with an opposite, وَبِهِ تَتَبَيَّزُ الْأَشْيَاءُ. Opposite allows you to know the. Sometimes if somebody asks you a word and you don't know the understanding of that word or you don't have the definition of that word, if I give you the opposite of it, you may be able to. For example, somebody says to you, tawil, and you don't know what tawil means. And they say to you, aksul qasir. But you know what qasir is, short. And they say it's the opposite of short. Automatically, you're going to be like, oh, tall. So here he's trying to tell you the opposite of it. The opposite is al-jahlu, ignorance. And jahl, he said, is tawassawur al-shay'i ala khilafi ma huwa bihi fi al-waqi'. So the author, rahimahullah, he mentions ignorance. And he says ignorance is tasawwur al-shay'i. Here, his usage of the word tasawwur al-shay'i is not good, عند المحققين. According to the scholars of tahqiq, who observe definitions, the word tasawwur is not a very good usage. It's better he used the ta'bir and the wording, what? It would best they use the ta'bir of al-idraq. Idraq would have been better for him to use. And that's another reason when we speak about, when we teach inshallah ta'ala, the kitab Sulum al-Munawraq fi ilm al-mantiq, then inshallah ta'ala we'll speak about these definitions better inshallah. Wal-jahlu jahl is tasawwur al-shay, is to perceive something. That's the first point. So remember, jahl is murakab min shay'aini, just like ilm was murakab min shay'aini. Knowledge was compounded of how many things? Two things. Ignorance is the same, based on his definition we're talking about here. فَالْجَهْلُ جَهْلُ is تَصَوُّرُ الشَّيْءِ. It is to perceive something. تَصَوُّر means انطباعُ صورتي في النفسي. It means what you internalized of it. تَصَوُّر means what you've internalized, what you have perceived, it means. Good. تَصَوُّرُ الشَّيْءِ. That's the first thing. And then he goes on to saying, عَلَى خِلَافِ مَا هُوَ فِي الْوَاقِعِ, which is the opposite to the reality out. The internalization and what you've internalized is opposite to what's externally out there. So there's two points now. Your perception and the reality out there. Those are the two things that are compounded of. Knowledge is what? Knowledge is what? Knowledge is your perception. And what's out there are in correlation. They are in correlation. They are together. Your perception doesn't go against what's out there. Okay, jahl on the other side, lakin, your perception and the reality out there is two different things. That's what the author, rahimahullah, said. Now here, the author didn't divide within jahl the types there are. He didn't categorize the types of ignorance there are. And jahl is of two types. The first type is jahl, which is murakkab, a compounded ignorance. And that basically means huwa idraku shay ala khilafi ma huwa fil waqi'. Are you with me? And that's just jahl murakkab. So when the author defined here, what did he define? He defined it jahl murakkab, which is what? To perceive something in opposite to what it really is in out. That's what a compounded ignorance is. It basically means your perception is not in relation and it is not in correlation with the reality out there. Whereas jahlun basir is the what? Huwa adamul idraki shay, ama adamul idraki bil kulliya. You have no perception whatsoever. You're simply aware that you don't know. And the reason why this is called jahlun murakkab, some of the scholars they say, is because there's two issues at hand. At hand, which is that you have a perception, are you there, which goes against the reality, and the second one is that your belief that what you've perceived is the reality. That's why it's compounded. You've perceived something that's not out there, you've internalized what isn't the reality, but what you believe is that you are right in your perception. Is compounded, and that's the hardest type of ignorance to deal with. It's the type of ignorance where the individual will argue their point, but in reality they have jahlun murakkab. They have what? Jahlun murakkab. Because their perception is wrong. And is it easier to pour in an empty cup or a full cup? The full cup, you have to first empty it, right? If you want to pour something new in there. The full cup, if you want to pour something in there, you first have to empty what's in there in order to pour something in there. Whereas the empty cup, you can pour something in there straight away. The jahlun basit is like that. The person is empty, they're ready, they're willing to take it on. So you can cure that. Are you there? The other one, which is jahlun murakkab, majority of the time, the person doesn't want to know. He doesn't want to know. Are you there? And rather, he shows enmity to the things that sometimes he is ignorant of. He shows enmity to it. As it said, من جهل شيئا عدا. If anybody has enmity towards something, he shows what? They show enmity. ولذلك, an alim was asked once, من جهل شيئا عدا. Anyone who's ignorant of something, he shows enmity to it. Is this something that can be found in the Quran? And the Shaykh looked down and he said, نعم. Allah said in the Quran, وَإِذْ لَمْ يَهْتَدُوا بِهِ فَسَيَقُولُونَ هَذَا إِفْقٌ قَدِيمٌ. Allah says, وَإِذْ لَمْ يَهْتَدُوا بِهِ, when they don't become guided to it, فَسَيَقُولُونَ, they will say to you, هَذَا إِفْقٌ قَدِيمٌ. They will say to you, this is a forged, it's made up, it didn't exist, this is a lie, this is deception, this is magic. That's what they will say to you. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوا, until when they came to you, قَالُوا, قَالَ, they said, أَكَذَّبْتُمْ بِآيَاتِي وَلَمْ تُحِيطُوا بِهِ عِلْمًا. You haven't encompassed it in knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the ayah, they disbelieve. قَالَ أَكَذَّبْتُمْ بِآيَاتِي, did you disbelieve in my verses? وَلَمْ تُحِيطُوا بِهَا عِلْمًا, and you haven't really what? You haven't really understood the reality of it. So those two verses show مَنْ جَهِلَ شَيْئًا عَدَى. And as the poet said, أَتَانَا أَنَّ سَهْلًا ذَمَّ جَهْلًا عُلُومًا لَمْ يَعْرِفُهُنَّ سَهْلُ أَمَا عُلُومًا لَيْسَ يَعْرِفُهُنَّ سَهْلُ عُلُومًا لَوْ دَرَاهَا مَا قَلَاهَا وَلَكِنَّ الرِّضَى بِالْجَهْلِ سَهْلُ. There's an individual by the name of Sahl. He says, أَتَانَا, it has come to us, أَنَّ سَهْلًا ذَمَّ جَهْلًا. It has come to us that this individual Sahal, his name is what? Sahal. He is rebuked and he has shown enmity to something based because he has no knowledge of it. عُلُومًا لَيْسَ يَعْرِفُهُنَّ سَهْلُ. He's actually what? He's rebuking and he's actually what? He's actually shown enmity to something which he doesn't have no knowledge of. The poet said, عُلُومًا لَوْ دَرَاهَا مَا قَلَاهَا. Knowledge that if he knew, he wouldn't have said what he said. I would have believed what he believed and would have dealt with it in the way he dealt with it. But then look what he says, وَلَكِنَّ الرِّضَى بِالْجَهْلِ سَهْلُ. But to be ignorant with ignorance is simple. So you see how his name is Sahl, but the last Sahl that's used in the poetry is not his name. It means simple. So, and of course there's a statement attributed to Ali ibn Abi Talib where he said, وَقِيمَةُ كُلُّ مْرِئٍ. Ali ibn Abi Talib said, the honor of everybody is مَا يُحْسِنُهُ, that which he perfects. وَالْجَاهِلُونَ لِأَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ أَعْدَاءُ. And the ignorant ones, they are enemies of the people of knowledge. Whenever they hate students of knowledge. صح? They hate ulama. Because the ulama, when they come, and the people of knowledge, when they come, what do they do to them? They clarify what's right from what's wrong. But this individual wants to keep the people in the darkness. He wants them to be shepherds of his. صح? He doesn't want to open the eyes for the people. That's why you find many contemporary du'ats who hate students of knowledge, who call them names, belittle them. And as Ali ibn Abi Talib said, وَالْجَاهِلُونَ لِأَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ أَعْدَاءُ. The ignorant ones are enemies of the people of knowledge. And sometimes they will belittle knowledges. Are you with me? There's a group, no need to say names, but they don't believe usul al-fiqh should be studied. They believe it's a waste of time. And this and that. So we say to them, أَتَانَا أَنَّ سَهْلًا ذَمَّ جَهْلًا عُلُومًا لَيْسَ يَعْرِفُهُنَّ سَهْلُ عُلُومًا لَوْ دَرَاهَ مَا قَلَاهَا وَلَكِنَّ الرِّضَى بِالْجَهْلِ سَهْلُ. It's easy to be happy with ignorance. That's the reality of your situation. Are you with me? لذلك, when you really look into a person and you feel and you see that they show enmity to a science of, within the science of the Sharia, the reason why is because they are ignorant. They don't know it. If you did know what the value and the quality of it, you wouldn't have shown enmity to it. And you wouldn't have shown hate to it. The reason you did is because you are jahil, ignorant. And I believe personally, there is nothing worse than ignorance. That's the worst cancer there is. That's the worst illness there is. A nation who is afflicted with ignorance, there's no way to uplift from them. There's no way to uplift from them any form of problems. Ignorance is the worst. It is the worst. Nabi Allah Nuh, when he did what he say, أعوذ بالله أن أكون من الجاهلين. When he asked Allah تبارك وتعالى إنه من أهلي, my son is for my children. Allah then tells him إنه عمل غير صالح. فلا تسألني ما ليس لك به علم. إني أعيدك أن تكون من الجاهلين. Allah tells him in this verse, he's not from your family. And then Allah says, I warn you from not to be from those who are ignorant. ولذلك Allah says in another ayah, إنما التوبة على الله للذين يعملون السوء بجهالة. Allah says the repentance is for those people who do what? إنما التوبة على الله للذين يعملون السوء. They do the evil, they do crimes, they do shortcomings بجهالة, with ignorance. That's the people who repentance is for. ولذلك السلف وهذه الأمة, the pious predecessors, أقوال have been transmitted that anyone who sins against Allah is a jahil. صح؟ Anyone who sins against Allah تبارك وتعالى and goes against Allah's command سبحانه وتعالى and chose to break the boundaries of Allah, he's a jahil. Because the ayah is clearly saying إنما التوبة على الله للذين يعملون السوء بجهالة, بجهالة, ignorance. Many of the salaf have been referenced. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari brings them if you look at his tafsir. So ignorance, ikhwani, is one of the things that we're created in. That every single day of our life that we need to get what? We need to get rid of. What does Allah tabarak wa ta'ala say? Inna aradna al-amanata ala samawati wal-ard wal-jibala fa'abayna yahmilna wa ashfaqana minha wa hamalaha al-insan innahu kana zaluman jahula. There's two characteristics that is embedded in us, and that is ignorance and oppression. What are the two characteristics that are placed inside us? Ignorance and what? Oppression. And why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send the Prophet? Look what it says, Allah says in this ayah. لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِي وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. Pay attention to this. Allah says, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah bestowed His blessings upon the believers. Pay attention here, brothers. It's a very important point. What did I just say right now? There are two characteristics which Allah placed in what? The creation. We have two characteristics which are within us. Can't take it out of us. Ignorance and what? And oppression. Inshallah ta'ala, in my upcoming series, inshallah, that I'm hoping to do, is I need to speak about this issue of the argument that some can say that if Allah created us with ignorance, and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, as He said in the Quran, وَاللَّهُ أَخْرَجَكُمْ مِنْ بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا. Allah brought you out of the wombs of your mothers not knowing anything. So where does the fitrah come into place? That's another whole subject, a whole another discussion, which inshallah ta'ala I'm hoping to do in my refutation and the debunking against the atheists. That's where I'm going to leave it for, inshallah ta'ala. But the point here right now is that the ayah tells us Allah has brought us out of the womb of our mothers not knowing anything. Also Allah tells us subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have two traits, two characteristics, which are what? Oppression and transgressions and oppression and ignorance. So we're ignorant and we're oppressive. But Allah told us that He sent a messenger who's there to cure these two elements from us. What does He say? Pay attention to this. لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا. Allah sent to us a messenger. What's His job? يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِ. He's reading on them the verses of Allah. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِ. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. And He purifies them. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Kitab is the Quran. وَالْحِكْمَةِ is the Sunnah. وَيُعَلِّمُ. He teaches them the Kitab and the Sunnah. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ means what? And He purifies them. Tazkiyah is in response to the oppression first part of the ayah. إِنَّ عَرَضَنَا الْأَمَانَةَ عَلَى السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ is to purify oppression from you. وَيُعَلِّمُنَا, it is to cure from you the ignorance that's in you. But the ayah tells us that it cures the ignorance from us in two ways. With two things. What are they? Al-kitab wal-hikmah. The hikmah is a sunnah. صح? How do we know that this? How do we know that the hikmah is a sunnah? How do we know that this hikmah means the sunnah? Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَذْكُرْنَ مَا يُتْلَى فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. The Quran and the Sunnah. That's what the ayah means. وَذْكُرْنَ مَا يُتْلَى. That That's being recited. So the Prophet ﷺ came based on the ayah, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. So he's teaching us and he's purifying us. So the job of a da'i is to always do the same. Just like it was the job of the Prophet to educate the people and to also purify the people from what? Purify them from what? From oppression. To also educate the people based on what? The Kitab and the Sunnah. To educate the people on the Kitab and the Sunnah. So they can, so this trait of ignorance can be taken from them. Oh Allah, uplift ignorance from us and oppression, and place in us knowledge and justice. When the author finished speaking about وَلَمَّا فَرَغَ الْمُصَنِّفُ مِنْ حَدِّ الْجَهْلِ, when he spoke about ignorance and he told us the definition of it and we spoke about its types now, the author goes into what is known as وَالْعِلْمُ الضَّرُورِيُّ. عِلْمُ الضَّرُورِيُّ is the immediate knowledge. Why do we call it the immediate knowledge? And why is it called عِلْمُ الضَّرُورِيُّ? It's the knowledge that comes مَا لَمْ يَقَعْ عَنْ نَظَرٍ وَاسْتِدْلَالٍ. It's the knowledge that comes, it's the knowledge that comes without what? Without any observation and without any deduction. You don't have to do any deduction and you don't have to come with any observation. It occurs. It's an immediate knowledge. It's already innate. It's placed in you. ولذلك, the author, he categorized knowledge in terms of how we perceive information in knowledge. How much types did he categorize it into? Two types. The first one he called it علم الضروري ما لم يقع عن نظر واستدلال. It's that which is an immediate knowledge that doesn't come by way of deduction and it doesn't come by way of observation. That's علم الضروري. The fact Allah exists, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's علم الضروري. It's a knowledge that's immediate. It's placed in everybody. That doesn't require any observation. It doesn't require any deduction. And that should not be a discussion. Then the author mentions, after that, العلم المكتسب. علم المكتسب is the knowledge that's brought by way of, you have to attain it. It's knowledge which you have to attain. And you have to gain. It's basically موقوف على النظر والاستدلال. The way to gain it is observing, it's empirical evidences, and it is also deduction. That's what's referred to as علم النظري. You have to deduction and empirical. And the author mentions it to you. From them is, the empirical is that which comes through what? You either have to smell it, you have to see it. العلم بالقواقع الواقع بأحد بإحدى الحواس الخمسة. Are you there? The first one of the two is what? علم الضروري is that which happens through what? For example, that which happens by smelling, tasting, and everything. He puts it inside there. The second one is al-ilmu, which is an ilmu tawatur, mutawatir, when the knowledge is mutawatir, multitude narration. Now that the author has told us, when we were defining, what do you call it, al-ilmu al-daruri and al-ilmu al-muktasab, what we were saying something, which is another, right? The author was using the word nadhar. Then he was forced to go into explaining what nadhar means. Are you with me? So when he defined it, what did he say? وَالنَّظَرُ هُوَ الْفِكْرُ فِي حَالِ الْمَنْظُورِ فِيهِ. Are you there? And he also defined what istidlal means. And he says, وَالِاسْتِدْلَالُ طَلَبُ الدَّلِيلِ وَالدَّلِيلُ هُوَ الْمُرْشِدُ إِلَى الْمَطْلُوبِ أَنَّهُ عَلَامَةٌ عَلَيْهِ. Because he kept using the word what? عِلْمُ الضَّرُورِي is what? مَا لَمْ يَقَعَ النَّظَرٍ وَاسْتِدْلَالٍ. And he said, عِلْمُ الْمُكْتَسِبِ is what? فَوَ الْمَوْقُوفُ عَلَى النَّظَرِ وَالْإِسْتِدْلَالِ. So what's النَّظَر وَاسْتِدْلَالِ, صح? What's النَّظَر and what is إِسْتِدْلَالِ? When he defined النَّظَر, he did something that is disliked according to the ulama al-mantiq. He did what is known as دور. He did something which is known as a دور. دور basically means أنه عاد في تعريفي. If in your definition it comes ما يتعلق بالمعرف اشتقاقا. The thing you're defining, if any of its root letters come into your definition, then this is دور. You're going in circles. And that's what he did. What did he say? والنظر نظر means هو الفكر في حال المنظور فيه. منظور is the اشتقاق which another and it shares. They both come from the أصل of what? النون والضاء والراء. صح؟ So the تعريف which is مختار, the definition which we're going to choose is النظر اصطلاحا he means هو حركة النفس is when your نفس works towards لتحصيل الإدراك, when your soul works to gaining perception of something. It is تفكر, it's actually thinking. That's why we're saying حركة النفس means is to ponder and to think فيما تطلب الإدراك in that which you're trying to attain perception of.